speaker is Suzanne Rooney-Latham. She's a senior plant pathologist with CDFA, and I just want to give a thanks to her and Cheryl for processing all the samples we sent her. I know without their help, a lot of things that I do and that I'm sure that all you folks do couldn't succeed without her, without their support, so I want to thank them. And with that, I want to present Suzanne, and she'll talk about common and uncommon diseases of oak and Tanoak.
Thanks for the introduction, Kim. I also want to thank Susan Frankel and the rest of the organizing committee for the invitation to come and speak about a little bit of a different topic. We're going to go beyond fight tophora. So despite what you've heard the last few days, some great talks about fight tophora more and other fight tophora species and the risks they present, there are other diseases on some of these posts. Oak, Tanoak, and Bay. So we're going to talk about some of these diseases and some of the tools that we utilize in our lab to diagnose some of these. And I'm going to do some acknowledgments from the get-go too, because I'm a lab pathologist and they don't let me out very much. And so we really rely on the people out in the field for their eyes, for their pictures, to help us in our diagnostics in the lab. And so I thank them for the various pictures that they supplied for my talk. So first off, I want to talk a little bit about some of the wood decay fungi. So as most of you know, fungi play a critical role in our ecosystems. They act as decomposers, saprotrophs, recyclers of plant debris, and without them, we'd be well over our eyeballs in organic matter. They can be broken down based on the type of matter that they decompose. Brown rock fungi, they cause this brown cubicle rot on the left, and that's a result of the fungus breaking down the lignin and the hemicellulose and the cellulose and leaving the lignin. Compared to white rot on the right, and that's when the lignin is broken down as well as the hemicellulose and cellulose. So it's kind of a spongy, white, punky rot that's left. So there's many important fungi that do this decomposition, but there are also some wood rot. Wood decay fungi that are pathogenic to living wood. And they can be broken down based on the rot. Do they cause a rot of the heartwood, the dead internal wood, or the living sap wood? So one example what group are malaria species. And these are often called oak root fungus. They have a really wide host range of conifers and hardwoods. This example, this is R. malaria mellia, probably one of the most widely known species and pathogenic species. It's characterized by these white mycelial fans or mats underneath the bark. And this causes a crown rot, a butt rot, as well as a root rot. It also can be characterized by the flush of mushrooms you often get in the fall. And then they also produce rhizomorphs, which are fungal root-like structures that are important for overwintering and spread from tree to tree. Here's a sample that came to us from an East Bay Park. This tree recently fell over just a couple months ago. It's a black oak. It's in an area known to have Phytophthora morum and as well as Phytophthora cinnamomi in the soils. The roots were examined. There was extensive rot in the bud and the roots of the tree. And this is one of those cases where molecular techniques really helped us. We isolated another species, R. malaria gallica, typically not as pathogenic, considered as pathogenic as mellia. But we also were able to confirm another wood rotting white rot fungus, polyporus umbellatus, from the same tree. So again, without our tools, we probably wouldn't have been able to put a name to this. And luckily, this tree fell, no one was injured, and we weren't able to confirm cinnamomum. And I think that over time, Cinnamon may have been involved, we don't know for sure, but definitely these wood rot fungi can over time, even if they're weaker, lead to this sort of decay. Ganoderma species, these are common, also common wood rotting fungi that cause bud and root rots. These are the characteristic basidiocarp conchs that are produced. These pictures from Ted and Liz. Usually by the time you see these, there's extensive rot already in the tree. So this is what the pictures that we get from you all in the field, when in reality this is sometimes a sample that we get in the lab. So this came in to the lab and it was probably weighed about 3 pounds. I call it the unknown rock fungus. It came in for identification. And morphology is great when you have characters to use spores and size of conchs and host species, but when you get something like this, what do you really do with it? And so luckily we have PCR techniques that we can use, and we were able to confirm that it was Ganoderma sessile. Who would have ever thought that that's what this was? But it made sense. It turns out this is a common host on, or a common pathogen on maple, and it turns out this tree, they removed a tree in this homeowner's yard the year before. It was a maple, brought in all this gravel, and then they were getting all these fruity bodies. So she was concerned that her kids, her grandkids were going to get sick. Anyway, so the power of photographs here. Here's another wood rotting fungi, Ganonotus andersonii. It causes, these were from tendons as well. Really common on oaks, causes canker disease, a lot of mortality associated with oaks from this. It produces these recipinate or flat fruity bodies underneath the bark. Again, pretty widespread and common in California. So all of these fungi, we have morphological characters to identify ones I just talked about. But I also talked about how molecular techniques can be used as well. But what about some of the other things that we don't have the large green bodies or, well, we use culturing, we use traditional methods, immunoassay, but we also have, our lab has evolved to use more DNA-based technologies, and the field is rapidly changing. There's about 120,000 known home species right now, but it's believed that there's probably 2 to 3.8 million million more fungal species out there yet to be described. So the door is opening for us. In fact, in 2017, more than 2,000 new fungal taxa species were described. So rapidly evolving, as Tyler talked about in his talk as well. We're just finding more and more things because we have the tools now to identify them. One such group here is the Botrytis fungi. This is a group that previously things were known as, oh, it's bot canker. Things were grouped as Botrytis diphtheria or just diplodia. But it turns out with their molecular tools, there's tons of species out there. Again, it's a large group of plant pathogenic fungal fungi that are opportunistic. But they can also be primary pathogens causing these cankers or diebacks. They have really, really wide host range, so some species are more specific and some are wider. They affect agricultural crops, horticultural crops, and forestry hosts. And it appears as though they can cross infect from agricultural crops, like fruit trees, into horticultural or forestry hosts. They're known worldwide. But there's approximately 23 described genera and 187 species known. Akeith Escalon and Shannon Lynch have done some work on this, as I think was we heard a little bit someone talk about before, looking at some of these canker pathogens associated with oak in California. And they have identified a lot of these. These are the ones that are known on these hosts in California. Of course, Botrytis diphtheria, Diplodia species, Diplodia corticula seems to be an emerging, a bigger pathogen in California than previously thought. I'll talk about that in a minute. Dophiarella species tend to be more weaker pathogens. And the Neophysococcum group, they used to be Fusococcums, and they're really emerging as important pathogens. Here's some symptoms from Keith and Shannon's paper, some of the coast live oak. You can see some of the flagging and dieback. And then when you cut into cross section, you see these wedge-shaped cankers. And botrysteria typically invade through pruning wounds. They're particularly a problem in trees that have been stressed. Here are some of the fruiting bodies and the spores that are produced that colonize the fruiting or the pruning wounds. So in Shannon and Keith's work, they were seeing Diplodia corticola kind of emerging as a big problem, causing a lot of mortality. And we are also seeing this pop up more in the lab. This is a Diplodia. This is a cork oak that was in Davis, California, a homeowner sample. And Diplodia corticola was originally described on cork oak in Europe, and that was really its known host range up until about 10 years ago. But this tree, it was showing a gradual decline over time, and we couldn't find any of those characteristic large wedge-shaped cankers. But there was just lots of tip dieback, and we were able to isolate Diplodia corticola from all of these canker margins of these tips. So it was causing this gradual decline over time. We're also seeing a lot more Diplodia corticola on Tanoak. This sample was from Elizabeth and Ted. They saw these beautiful cankers on Tanoak in the Bay Area. And on this canker, you can actually see stromatic tissue. It's actually, the fungus is actually fruiting on there. And with the use of molecular tools, we didn't even need to culture. We were able just to identify it just using PCR pretty rapidly. And Chris Lee is also seeing this, a lot of flagging associated with Tanoak. Mendocino County, Humboldt, and it's been seen down in Southern California on Tanoak too. So it appears to be a bigger problem than we previously thought. We've also found a new foliar and twig disease on California Bay. And this was discovered partially because of remora. We're out in the field now scouting trees, looking for remora and more. And this was discovered by Lisa Bell from Sonoma County. This is a park in Sonoma County, Redwood State Park, that's known to have Phytophthora remorum. And she first noticed these symptoms on bay, this dieback defoliation. And she thought into the progression of the symptoms just didn't look like remora. And so she sent us some samples. Here's what the symptoms look like on the leaves. And we tested it for Phytophthora remorum extensively using our PCR, and it was negative. But we did culture a new species of Calonectria from these leaf spots. And you can see it looks similar to Phytophthora remorum on the foliar symptoms, but it produces these really characteristic stem lesions that we really don't see with Phytophthora remorum. And it also causes quite a lot of defoliation, you can see on the photo to the right. We also sampled nearby Tanoak that was showing some foliar kind of tip necrosis, not spotting so much, but we also could see spotting on the stems, and we were able to isolate the same Calonectria species from the Tanoak as well. So this was in, I believe, 2010, 11, and there somewhere after we had a lot of rainfall that we saw in Sonoma. And we didn't really know how far the disease extended in California. We'd only seen it in this one location. But in February of 2017, we were getting reports, again, from areas of Santa Cruz and Santa Clara County that are known to have Phytophthora remorum, saying, hey, what's Phytophthora remorum doing this year? It's just defoliating trees and taking trees. They looked terrible in these areas. And so we were able to get some samples. Chris went out and sampled. I think Ted and Liz went out as well. And we were able to confirm the same Calonectria species in those locations too. So it seems to be a disease that really picks up a lot when we have heavier years of rainfall, winters of rainfall. So here's what it looks like. Again, it's a Calonectria. That's the same genus that causes boxwood blight. It has a slender cladium anamorph. We did pathogenicity tests on bay. After 6 days, you were able to see nice foliar spotting that progresses. And then by about 35 days in really high humidity and optimal temperatures, you start to get complete defoliation. So it's a really good pathogen of bay. And so the final disease I want to talk about just briefly is an anthracnose-like fungus of members of the Fagaceae. Previous to this work, it was thought that oaks got Discula porcina and Tubacchia giant. Those were the primary anthracnose pathogens of oak. But it turns out, we've been doing a lot of isolations, it turns out there's a lot more anthracnose-like fungi out there. There's pneumonia, pneumoniopsis. This one appears to be really pretty widespread. We've isolated it and confirmed it from many different counties, I think at least 10 or 15 counties in California. It's most problematic on California black oak. And these pictures were from Jenny Hoff. She's a botanist with Tuolumne County, the Forest Service up there. And she was noting this progression up in the right in the late fall in the leaves. And it would do this tip necrosis, and then the leaves would become necrotic, and then they'd stay attached on the tree. And then this is the new spring growth the next year. And you can see these leaves should have fallen, but they're still there. And it turns out what we think is going on, here's some more pictures of the disease. You can see it's causing, over time it causes dieback of the tree. And you can see the progression up here and over time, how it progresses, the old leaves. What we think is going on is these old leaves, the inoculum is staying on the leaves, and it's serving as, the fruiting bodies are staying on the leaves, and they're serving as inoculum the next year. So when you get that new spring flush, it infects the new leaves, and then it's kind of has a latent period, and then you get symptoms in the fall. So this is another disease. When I first heard about the symptoms, it reminded me of another Tubacchia disease I read about in Iowa called bur oak blight, caused by Tubacchia iowensis. And really without sequence identification, it would have been really hard to confirm this. I'm gonna skip slides a little bit. And this kind of shows Tubacchia iowensis is very closely related to this new Tubacchia that we've called Tubacchia California. And just quickly, some other symptoms. It occurs, we found it on chinkapin, we found it on Quercus lizazinia, as you can see here. This is one of the more dramatic symptoms. It causes some running along the veins, but a little bit different than that on Quercus colloquii. And then we've also, Chrisley has also seen it on Tanoak up north, causing some dieback and foliar symptoms. So those were all the diseases I wanted to talk about. Again, I'd like to acknowledge the following.